My daughter's 15, and she's having a slumber party. She's having all these friends come over, and I'm a really funny dad. My daughter loves to spend time with me when she's having a slumber party. She loves for me to come teach, say, ghost stories. So I say, hey, hon, I'm going to come and give all your friends ghost stories. And she texts back to me, SMH. What does SMH stand for from a 15-year-old? SMH stands for shake my head. Shake my head. Listen, SMH. Do me a favor. Take your three fingers like this. Everybody take your three fingers like this and put them right here on your throat. Right here. Right here. Put them right here for a second. SMH. 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 These three fingers represent SMH. These are the, thank you. You can put it down. These are the germs that live right here that we have to be concerned with. SMH. Strep pneumoniae, H flu, MCAT. Why am I bringing that up right now? Because if we're going to talk about urgent care infections, we have to talk about these three germs. Because guys, where do these three germs love to go? They love to go here, here, and here. These are the primary players in our upper respiratory infections. SMH, strep pneumoniae, H flu, MCAT. Now, when it comes to infectious disease, to a lot of us, it can almost be overwhelming. I'm telling you, if you look at fundamental basics, it ain't that hard. It's something we teach a lot about on our emergency medicine videos. You got to know your infectious disease. I believe PAs and nurse practitioners are on the front line of infectious disease and addiction, and a lot of us are very ill prepared for it. So let's talk about the common infections. My goal here is to make sure you're updated with the most current information about common infections in an urgent care. I'm a huge fan of UpToDate. I believe it's unbiased information and it's very good. I'm also a big fan of Sanford's Guide. Everything I'm going to show you here is literature based out of Sanford Guide. It's all referenced. So bottom line is, when it comes to working up someone for an infectious disease, first and foremost, make sure you get a valid temp. And what does that mean? It means rectal temps in kids and demented geriatric patients, because if they don't keep the thermometer probe under their tongue, you get a falsely low temp, and that can burn you. I'm speaking from experience. How would it burn you, John? Because a geriatric patient that comes in short of breath from a nursing home, what are the two most common causes of that? It's pneumonia versus failure. Those are the most common. Now, what's the big decision point? Temp. If they got a temp of 103, they're short of breath, your job is easy. It's easy. If they're euthermic, you can think it's failure. And if you squirt a pneumonia patient with Lasix, they have bad outcomes. You increase their mortality. You dehydrate their pneumonia. Okay? Number two, understand that when it comes to a CBC, as a hospitalist guy, a CBC is one of, that's an incomplete picture. Don't call and say, hey, I think someone's infected, their white count's 18,000. There's three numbers I want. I want three numbers from you. I want white count, neutrophils, and bands. Give me all three of those. That tells me you're thinking at a high level. You're thinking like an internist. You're thinking like a critical care provider, okay? So if you have someone who thinks, in fact, if you said, John, I got someone with a belly pain, a white count of 12,000, I'm going to be like, so? Yeah, but they got 18 bands. Oh man. Okay. Just so you guys know, a band count, that is in reference to a left shift. Some people think a high neutrophil count's a left shift. It ain't. It's high band count. Your normal band should be a couple percent. That's physiologic. If you have bands that go into double digits, 10, 12, 14, 18, this is what I preach. I hope you can hear this. A high band count is as sinister as a positive troponin. Okay? If you say, hey, John, I got a 12,000 white count. I'm like, that's nothing. But they got 18 bands. Now you really got my attention. Did you get a surgical consult? Did you do a lactate level? That's what I'm going to say. Did you scan them? Okay? Guys, for 15 years, most of the time I worked at night. So most of the time I called docs were at night. What do you think the attention span is of a doc at 3 in the morning? How long do I got? About 8 seconds, right? The conversations will go like this. First off, time out. I'll talk about this in the second part of today. Anytime you talk to a consultant that you don't know well, it always starts with, sorry to bother you. There's a reason for that. I'll share it with you later. Hey, doc, it's John from the air. I'm sorry to bother you. Listen, yeah, I got to pay. That's all they're hearing right now. And they have 24 bands. All of a sudden, the doc sits up and says, start over. Because now you're telling me the person's really sick. Okay? Urine, chest x-ray, brain and belly. So bottom line is there's five major body systems we got to think about infection. Wind and water, brain and belly, and then skin. Those are the big five that we look at. Understand something, guys. Abdominal pain and when to pull the trigger on a CAT scan is a lecture way beyond what I can talk about right here. If you're younger in medicine, you should run more CAT scans. You just should. You don't want to get burned early, but you got to develop an astute physical exam. You got to get good, okay? Meningeal signs. Colleagues, I want to warn you about something that I know of two patients that died because of mid-levels or advanced practitioners, if you will, getting bad advice about potential meningitis. Please listen to this, okay? Here's my question. If you walk into a room and you got a guy who's got a fever 103, headache, neck pain, and altered mental status, and you're kind of going through it and all of a sudden it hits you, you go, oh shit, I think they got meningitis. Like, that's called a positive sphincter sign. You go, oh shit, I think they got, damn, okay? You get positive sphincter sign that you really think the patient you're managing has got bacterial meningitis. As soon as your sphincter puckers, you push a button on your stopwatch. Here's my question. How long do you have to squirt antibiotics? What is the appropriate period of time to wait after a presumptive diagnosis of meningitis to squirt with antibiotics? What's reasonable? Critical Care Society gives you 1 hour. Okay? So what's the barrier to squirting with antibiotics right away? Well, we kind of want the LP, right? We'd like to have the LP before we put antibiotics on board. What's the problem with that? A lot of us don't do LPs. You have 1 hour. Let me tell you how I know of two people that died. You see a patient you think's got bacterial meningitis. But I don't do LPs here. I can't do an LP. So I call this ER. Hey, doc, sorry to bother. Listen, I got a guy who thinks he's got bacterial meningitis, and I'm concerned about him, and I don't do LPs. So all of a sudden, the doc gives you some really, really, really fatally bad advice. They say, don't put antibiotics on board. Ship them over here by ambulance. As soon as they get here, I'll go in the room, I'll tap them right away, and then I'll put them on antibiotics. If the patient has Neisseria, strep pneumoniae, in their spine, they will die. They will die. Okay? You can't do that. You got 1 hour. Colleagues, if you see a patient you think has bacterial meningitis and you can't get the LP with 1 hour, do blood cultures and load them with antibiotics. Do it before you make the phone call. Don't let the doc at the other side say, don't put them on antibiotics. You say, oh man, I'm sorry. They just got the 2 grams of ceftriaxone on the Vanco's going in now. I'm sorry. Sorry. Wow, you're a very good doctor. I'm sure you're going to figure it out. Okay? Okay? Do you understand? Under that scenario, the patient may die. The patient may die, but it's not on you. You didn't delay antibiotics, okay? I think it's super important. Now, when it comes to sepsis, wind, water, brain and belly, and skin. Now, I just want to give a brief talk about what makes a patient septic. If you look at the SIRS criteria, I think it's a little bit crazy and it's a little bit abstract. It's more for researchers. I want to give you a tool that will really help you. It helped me a lot. Now, they have what's called the SOFA scoring. And this is, I think of this kind of like the NIH stroke scale. It's very busy, very heavy. It's probably good if you're inpatient. When you look at all of this, that doesn't really work for me, but I want to give you a tool that will work for you. It's called the Quick SOFA. Evidence-based way to give a sniff test. Is my patient sick? It's a 3 Bs. It's a 3 Bs. It's a 3 Bs. It's brain, belly, blood pressure. Holy cow. Brain, are they altered? Breathing. Are they tachypneic? Blood pressure. Colleagues, I will eventually do a lecture called the Rodney Dangerfield Vital Sign. What vital sign is the most disrespected vital sign that we have? But it is one of the most important. It's your respiratory rate. First and foremost, if a nurse brings you a vital sign that says a respiratory rate of 16, how confident are you that the patient's breathing at 16? Guys, the golden rule of vital signs is no respiratory rate is valid unless you take it yourself. You gotta take your, guys, let me tell you why this is so important. If you watch me, when it comes to acid base, this hand is carbon dioxide, it's an acid. This hand is bicarb, it's my base, okay? When my thumbs are together, my pH is normal. So when someone becomes acidotic from sepsis, what happens is they produce lactic acid. Watch what happens. Bicarb drops because trying to buffer the lactic acid. So now I got too much carbon dioxide relative to the bicarb. They start becoming tachypneic. Respiratory rates are very, very important, but you gotta take it yourself or you'll get spurned, okay? When I see these three things, it tells me my patient's septic. Now, this is another very, very, very important mnemonic. Here's the question. What is the difference between a kid with 103 temp that has otitis media versus 103 temp and meningitis? How do I walk in a room and say, this one's okay, this one's okay, this one is super sick. This is the mnemonic, it's called tickles. I was super concerned about missing a septic kid in my younger days. This mnemonic is flawless. It gives you the right set of eyes. Is my kid really sick or not? Tickles, T is tone. And you've got to document in this chart and communicate it to the doc or the collaborating doc, your consultants. Do they have a weak tone or a strong tone? Are they pushing you away? I want a kid who fights my ear exam. I and C go together. That's irritability and consolability. Ladies and gentlemen, a sick kid should not like you, but they should like their parent. So I document appropriately irritated by provoking examiner, consoled by parent. T-I-C-K. K is their cry. That goes very aligned with their tone. Is it loud and vigorous or is it wimpy? A wimpy cry is very concerning to me, especially when the pitch of the cry doesn't change with a venipuncture. L is labor. Are they laborious in their breathing? If you're taking care of a sick kid, you have to take off their shirt. You have to look at their chest wall. I'm going to ask you a question right now. In your mind right now, if I said I have a one-year-old with moderate respiratory distress, he's got retractions, in your brain, can you see that? Do you know what a one-year-old with retractions looks like? On a scale from 1 to 10, how sure are you that you know it? And if you don't know it, you need to YouTube it. Okay, you need a YouTube to see what that looks like so you never miss it, because the respiratory rate is really important, especially in kids. E is environment. Are they appropriately stimulated by the environment? And that's age relative, okay? Where if it's a baby, it could be the startle reflex or the Moreau reflex. As they get older, you need to know how to appropriately stimulate your kids to make sure they're engaging with you right. I used to go into a room with a SpongeBob sticker on my forehead and say, "Guy, I was going to bring you a SpongeBob sticker, but I can't find it. Nurse, do you know where the SpongeBob sticker is?" And the kid's like, "It's on your head." "No, it's not on my head, young man. I'm an adult. There's no sticker on my head." "It's on your head." The more they try to convince me the sticker's on my head, the more I know they're fine. If it's a kid who's 8 or 9 years old, especially with belly pain, a lot of times they come in for secondary gain. This is a great technique. I will say to them, "Listen, don't tell your, I'm not going to tell your mom. You got a boyfriend. Come on, do you have a boyfriend?" "No, I don't." Then you can examine their belly while you're talking about their boyfriend and they're completely distracted. Very helpful. Last is suckling. Get a good history of their feeding. Colleagues, a kid with otitis media, they'll cut down on their solids almost insignificant, but they'll still drink about half normal. Kids with a bad infection, they ain't taking nothing in. This is what you need to communicate on your charts, and this is what you got to communicate to your attending docs.